Good evening, everyone, and welcome to A World Awakening. I am here, slightly sunburned from working outside in the yard today. But still, you know, a little pasty, a little red, but, you know, still me, still Annie. And, of course, I have the Princess Peanut Buttercup is right here. She's relaxing at the moment beside me, and there's some belly rubbing going on. But she's good. She'll make an appearance later on, certain of it. And tonight, I am very, very happy to announce that at least one of my two guests is here. We're still waiting. I believe we're still waiting on Mr. Tenney.
Nope. And he is here.
He's here. Oh, God bless him. Oh, my God. That's so great, Bill. That's so great. Thanks for pulling all of this together on, you know, relative short notice, Bill.
I'll have a great show with the both of them. So,
well, when I put up that they were coming on today, a couple of days ago, I put, he is the king of the realm of the weird, who dubbed me long ago as the queen of high strangeness. But Jessica rules the freaking multiverse, you know, and that's what I put out. So without further ado, let's bring on John E. L. Tenney and Jessica Knapik.
Hey.
Hi.
Hi. And there's Toad. There's Toad. And here's the peanut butter cup. So we've got, they were on the poster. So they have to at least make the parents, right?
What do I have? I have a wolf man.
You have a wolf man. John, I have a little surprise for you. You're going to actually have something else very soon when I see you, I believe, next weekend. That is a very special gift for you. And it's not a gift from me. It's a gift from my sister, Christine. There's just this little story behind it, which I will share with you, and then I will, and then we'll play show and tell, and I'll hold it up to the computer. Okay. So Jessica was kind enough to send me a lovely little video that you made of your office space and all of your lovely trinkets and toys and everything that you have that keep you company when you do your fabulous podcast, What's Up Weirdo, shameless plug, which I can do because number one, it's my show, and number two, that's your show. So I'm just, you know, you know, if you got a platform, use it, for Christ's sake. So anyway, I'm watching this video and I'm laughing and I'm thinking, oh my God, how sweet. He's still really a kid at heart. He's got so much.
When you're done talking, I'm going to tell you a story about that room.
Okay, great. Yeah, well, you know, we only have an hour, so I'll try to whip it along here. So anyway, last May, I went to an event in North Carolina and I found this thing that I just loved. I just loved it. I thought it was like the most gruesome, horrible, fabulous thing I had ever seen. And I bought it while I was at the Paracon. And I came home and I was staying with Christine and my mother at the time, and I gave it to her and I wanted to thank her for taking care of Peanut in my absence. And she just looked at me and she looked at it and she said, "That, Anne, that is the weirdest thing I have ever seen, ever. Why are you giving me this?" Okay. And and I just, well, I guess I thought you would like it. Well, this little guy has been living out on the back porch for the better part of a year in all kinds of terrible conditions, you know, windswept rain and stuff that gets in through the screens. And he just, you know, I felt like he was getting screwed. And so, and he really does belong to you. So I asked her tonight if she would let me take him up next week to Detroit. And she said, yes, absolutely. But make sure that John knows that the gift is from me, not you. I said, okay. So this is him. And
look at this guy.
He has ripped his own eye out with his own hand. He is. And I know because I have a photograph of you wearing socks.
Oh, yeah.
No foam socks. And Bill, you know, put it on the screen if you loaded it, babe, because, you know, if not, I'll share it on Facebook. But so I just need to know if you love him and if you would like him to come live in your office with you.
Yes, please.
Where he will get proper respect.
Yes, and not will, left and out be friends color. With the other gnomes that are around.
Okay, excellent. That's wonderful. That's wonderful. And then there's more to the story, but I'll tell you when I get there, you guys will howl. Okay, now tell me your story.
Okay, so people who don't know, you do, and Jess does, and Katie does, and Toad does. But like for a few years, I was taking care of my mother and father when they were living at my house. I moved them in with me, and it was a very stressful, traumatic time. Had lost a lot of my light. Like, I was giving so much to them, and just, like, it was burning me out. So, and this was their bedroom. This is the room my mom died in that I'm in right now. And so after I moved my dad back up north and got him settled, I had this room, and I was like, I'm never going to go in that room ever again. And then I thought about all of the things that my mother had ever done for me. And I was like, my mom would hate that I owned a house and couldn't go into a room because of her.
Yes. Yes.
Like, she would want me to use my house.
Right.
You know, all she had ever done was try and take care of me and give me a safe, happy place to live. So I went up in my attic and I found all of the things that had been put away for years and created. Now I spend more time in this room than I spend anywhere else in the, because all of the things that I love here are here. So this isn't the office research room. I don't even think, has Jess, have you ever been upstairs to see the actual office up there?
I don't know. Jessica, can you hear us, sweetheart?
Yeah. Am I breaking up?
No, we can hear you now. John wanted to know if you had ever seen the actual office upstairs.
Yeah.
I couldn't remember because I take so few people up there. But yeah, that's where all the...
A few times.
Yeah, that's where all the books and file cabinets and everything are. This is the playroom. This is all of the toys and science fiction and comic books and... what's crazy too, right, is that like... I don't think people realize how closely intertwined science fiction and fantasy is with the magical world that we live in. Like, most of the people are magical creators, right? Like, whether we know it or not, there's actually Rachel Pollack, who was a comic book writer. I don't know if she's passed. I know she was in hospice a few days ago. Neil Gaiman was writing about her. But aside from like all of her comic books, I have all of her tarot books. She was like this massive, like the tarot influence on me growing up that I wouldn't have known about if I didn't read comic books.
Wow. Yeah. Well, see, I mean, people are such snobs about that shit, you know, and it seems to me that you should just broaden your horizons wherever you can broaden your horizons. You know, what are you attracted to? What calls to you? What speaks to you?
Yeah. And I always think it's interesting, like, whether you go like to anyone's house, like the diversity of stuff in people's houses, Jess knows this, like you walk from one room to a next and your personality is on display in every room. It's not just like hidden in one area, right? Yeah. Or it doesn't just come out at Halloween. You know, you walk into my family room and there's a life mask of Bela Lugosi, but it's right next to an Oscar Peterson jazz record, which, and you just see the reflection of the whole person instead of, you know, what they portray themselves as.
Well, I know I just came off of doing Soul School with Jeff Turner, who, you know, from UFO Contact. And we were talking about that, you know, about allowing ourselves to be whole people, you know, letting in the darkness and the light, just being everything, you know, omnipresent. And I think that ultimately that will lead us in our spiritual ascension to a realization of oneness, that everything is one thing, that everything is consciousness and energy, and it is an amalgamation. It's all just a recipe for us being successful human beings. We just have to allow ourselves to tap into every single element of ourselves even if it's unpleasant. We just feel it for a little while and then tell it to go away, you know, but still let it in and greet it. And as Jeff said, you know, when the dark lady in the black dress shows up knocking at your door, she's got a message. Let her in and have a cup of coffee with her. Don't slam the door in her face.
I was bothering Jess. Jess, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Where are you?
Somewhere in Ohio.
Okay. I figured you're on the road still somewhere in Ohio.
Yeah.
Jess is on a secret trip. Jess is on a secret trip I couldn't go to because I have a protest I have to go to on Sunday.
Oh, good. Protest for me while you're at it. I don't care what it is. Just make your voice heard.
No, he's going to a protest.
I know. I know. He said he's going to a protest and you're going to Cincinnati.
On purpose. I know.
She got secret plans.
And next weekend, we'll all be together in Holy Toledo.
It's true. It's been a while.
It's been since Halloween. Yeah. And, Bill, I know I don't have my private chats open, but I'm not seeing any signs of life with Bill. But I did send him a picture that was taken with a FLIR camera. You know, are you familiar with those? The FLIR? Yeah. They kind of measure energy output. Julie DeMay took a picture of the farm. And Bill, if you're there, if you're like there, put the picture up. If not, John, I'll be sending it to you in text. Okay. It is amazing. Bill, where are you? I know he's there. He's there somewhere. He is. It's an amazing, amazing picture of the energy output. So listen, the two of you, while you were at the farm, what did you pick up? I mean, I never even had really a chance to ask you how you processed that whirlwind trip, how you were there just for a few hours. But I know that it was an eventful trip. And I've not yet had the opportunity to ask either or both of you what it meant to you, or, you know, if it was something extraordinary for you.
Jess, you can go first.
I loved it. I thought it was cozy. I thought the whole place was cozy. It wasn't scary to me. It was, and I'm sure it's because of you too and your energy and just being around. I don't know. I can't explain it. I wasn't scared.
That's the farm taken with a FLIR camera.
Crazy.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
I know. It's amazing. It's
all energy.
Yeah, it really is a magical place. I mean, the energy there. And yes, I agree, Jess. It's a lot of it has to do with the energy that I bring into the house as well. I know. I stir things up. Ken DaCosta called me about 4 hours ago and he said, I know you're getting ready to do your shows and I know you got stuff going on and I know it's dinner time, but I'm here with this great crowd. Cody and Satori are here and I got Julie DeMay with me and all of her equipments and her gadgets and her gizmos. And I just wanted to know if you could, you know, say hi to everybody and, you know, greet our crowd because we're doing an overnight investigation tonight. And so I talked with them for a few minutes. I'm always thrilled, so happy to do that. But I also know that every time I do and they put it on speakerphone, the spirits hear me too. They know that I'm talking to them as well. And so I not only give messages to the human beings, the living beings that are working and being in that house together, but also open that door up to spirit as well. And inevitably, I get calls the next day. Oh, my God, Andrea. Really? You know, we caught this and we caught that and we caught the other thing. And it's because we're opening up a dialogue. And right. It's energy exchange.
Has anyone ever done experiments with you, like, because since everything is connected and we know that there's this interaction, and we know that distance really doesn't make a difference. Has anyone ever done experiments where you're in California and they're doing an experiment in the house to see if there's an immediate reaction? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there always is. There's never been a time that the activity didn't go like right through the roof, that all the pretty lights started coming on, you know, as soon as my voice came through. One of the most awesome things that's ever happened to me there was through Cody and Satori. And I believe it was over last Halloween or maybe sometime in the summer, but the spirits got very, very active all of a sudden while I was there. And the tapping was going on like crazy. And Satori's like, okay, I can't talk to all of you at once. So you have a message for, I'm feeling that you've got a message for someone. And they spelled out my name. And then she said, okay, how are they started? A-N-D. And she finished. And then she said, okay, what's the message? How many words? So she was telling them to work together in tandem so that they could fashion a simple statement that she would be able to spell out, and their message directly to me while I was sitting on the sofa was this: we miss your family.
Wow. Mm.
50 years later.
Dang. Well, I mean, we don't know how time works, right? Like,
or even if it exists.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. So interesting to me.
I know. Isn't it all fascinating? It's just so wonderful. Are we going to have fun next week?
Oh, for sure. Absolutely. I've always been, the thing that fascinates me about you in that house is, like, I've never had a connection to a property before, really. Mm-hmm. And so it's interesting in that sense that, like, the property itself, I mean, the spirits are there, sure, but they're generating their own kind of unique energetic field. Mm-hmm. And I've just, do you feel like when you're driving there, do you feel it getting closer?
I feel it from here. Yeah. I feel it at 40,000 feet. I felt it in Scotland. You know, mm-hmm. It doesn't matter where I am on the planet. It doesn't. My mother said something very profound when we moved out in 1980. She said, we can leave this farm, but the farm will never leave us. And I don't think she even knew at the time what a profound, significant statement that she was making. Because yeah. It is, you know, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, and the words for marriage, that happened. Now, mm-hmm. That is literally, for me, the only place that feels like home. Do I ever want to live there again? Nope, I don't, because I don't ever want to be that physically uncomfortable again. I'm either freezing to death or burning up and, you know, nothing but horsehair plaster and clapboard. Sorry, not my idea of a good time. I prefer to live in the 21st century with heat and air conditioning and with, you know, all the accoutrement. I like
the fact that you said it's like the wedding vows, except the only part that doesn't apply is until death do we part, like, because even after death you're still together.
Exactly. That's the part, because we don't.
Yeah.
Because we don't part. And that's the real beauty of it for me. It will always be my home in heart. Rhode Island is, you know, the flag for Rhode Island is an anchor with the word hope on it. Mm. It is absolutely perfect for me, for that place, for where I come from, my roots. But that is the only place in my whole life that has ever felt permanent. And eventually that house is going to fall down. But that right. place, that place in the country, the old Richardson Arnold homestead, will always live on in me.
Yeah. And those, you know, a lot of, obviously, like you said, that house will eventually not be there one day. Like, who knows how far in the future, but we all know as investigators that land holds a memory, like whether you can walk in. I mean, I've said this for years and years, like one of the places that, like I said, I'm not really connected to any place in particular, but just doing what we do, like whenever I go to Gettysburg, like you can just feel the land mm-hmm. and its memory of and everything that's happened there. Or you go into a allegedly haunted location, like you can find the room, right? Like even if the stuff isn't there anymore, like it still holds its energy and its memory.
Mm-hmm. Jessica, how long have you been doing bona fide paranormal investigations?
Oh gosh, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I went to haunted locations long before I was friends with Tenney, but not, I wouldn't call them official investigations, but I visited a lot of haunted locations. But yeah, I don't know, forever ago. I was always weird. I always wanted to go creepy places. I like a lot of like movie locations too, horror movie locations and historic stuff.
Yep. So yeah. You're just drawn to it naturally. Mm-hmm. Is it because you had experiences as a child?
Yeah, I saw ghosts in my childhood home. I saw a cowboy in my childhood bedroom before. And like, I always tell people, I know I saw something. If I know their whole outfit, like I'm not making it up if I know what they were wearing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I used to see ghosts in that house a lot.
I believe I texted you yesterday something about being a badass cowgirl. So now that
yep, it's so weird.
An entirely different meaning. A deeper meaning. Yeah.
Yeah. I only saw that once. I have no idea what that was about. And it's not like I grew up in like a Western state. I grew up in Michigan. Like, why was there a cowboy? It doesn't make any sense, but I don't know.
Well, you know, Michigan used to be the Wild West, darling. I mean, you know, you could have been coming up against a spirit that was there 300 years ago. And that land was just being not just settled, being seen. Yeah. By Western Europeans, you know, 300 years ago.
You know, what's crazy is I'm just thinking about this now with Jess's experience, and it's kind of, I don't know why it hasn't clicked before, but like, Jess, you've heard me talk about like going to Mount Olivet because people see Superman and a cowboy there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's Tom Tyler. There's an actor buried in that cemetery who played a cowboy from Hamtramck, Michigan. I wonder if you got a proto glimpse of Tom Tyler in
you know
your
what
childhood.
While you were starting that story, I just now put something together too that I've never put together ever. My parents' living room, like the stuff, I don't know what the fuck was going on around this time, but you know how people used to have more like themes for their houses, like country or like, so the theme for our living room was Southwestern, which doesn't make any sense. But we had like a wood wall way before people were doing wood walls. We had like cactus stuff, like big glass cactuses. And the couch was like a Southwestern theme. And I never put it together in my brain right now that there was a cowboy ghost there. He was probably like, this is my shit. This is my whole shit. I never thought of it, I swear, until right now. But also me and my mom used to go antiquing a lot. So maybe one of the like weird Southwest things that they had in the living room, it like came with that. Like
maybe there was energy in that house that actually was perhaps a little coercive or maybe even traveling with you from, you know, I would like the house decorated. You know, I have my house in Florida. I have a spirit and his name is George and he didn't die in the house. He died at the hospital, but he had a stroke at the house. So his last memories were of the house. And as soon as I walked in that house, my father found it. And then I moved down a couple of years later, you know, and leave it to my father to pick a haunted house, of course. And stands to reason. And I walked in the house and I'm like, I feel this. And who is he? And he doesn't like me. He thinks I'm way too outspoken, that I'm incredibly vulgar. That I'm just an off the rails radical feminist. Mm-hmm. He does not like the way I have decorated certain rooms in the house. because I have like a Victorian boudoir in my bedroom. It's all lamp, you know, fancy lace and pretty and all mauve colors and stuff. And he doesn't like that. He thinks it's way too femmy. Doesn't appreciate that I did not plant a garden. I don't have the time to plant a fucking garden. You plant the garden. I have stuff to do. You know, I gave him, I put the terrace garden in. If that's not good enough, too bad. And, you know, so I've been working with him. Every now and then he gets really aggravated. And the way that he aggravates me, because I am a Libra, is he moves all the artwork in the house and tilts it to the side, one side or the other. I know it's rude, but I can walk into somebody's house and apologize to them as I am walking over to their wall and straightening out a picture that has been slightly askew. He knows that's part of my personality. I can't help it. This has to be lined up. Where's the plumb line? You know, where's the, you know, there's just, okay. And so when he gets aggravated with me, he moves all the artwork, every single piece of artwork in the house. But I do believe before I move on from this house, which I probably will, into something, I need a bigger house. Actually, I do. I just, you know, I'm going to turn him into a raging feminist. He's going to be much nicer to his wife on the other side. And he's gonna lose a lot of his attitude as I'm working on him from this side and dragging him spiritually into the 21st century, whether he likes it or not. And you know, I think we can have those interactions with spirit.
When you were talking about, influencing, so I'm thinking back to the probably late 90s, but I was doing an investigation. This family in Troy, Michigan, they thought they had something, they had weird energy in their house. They didn't know if it was ghosts. They just knew something weird was happening there. Mm-hmm. But the one thing that piqued my interest was I walked into a room and it was, there was like a drink holder that was a globe that had like all of this maritime stuff on it. And the walls were like shiplap, and it was just this one room. And I was like, oh, who like loves the maritime stuff? And they were like, we didn't know what to do with this room. So we like just picked a theme and ran with it. And I was like, oh, that's cool, whatever. And then as I investigated, I found two families prior to that family, the guy who had owned the house, in his obituary, all they did was talk about the fact that he was in the Navy. His nickname was the Commodore, and he loved sailing. And I was like, oh, this guy got them to fucking decorate that room.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just like Jessica's childhood home.
Now I got to ask my dad, why the fuck? Because we have no connection. My dad's never even been out west. Like, neither of them. It doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm. You had a cowboy doing feng shui in your childhood, right? House.
which is, I believe, absolutely plausible, because they do communicate with us all the time, whether we're listening or not. It's really all about how tuned in are we, how receptive are we in any given moment. Are we distracted by all the external blah blah blah? Or are we there and focused on them, and accepting and acknowledging their existence and welcoming and embracing with them?
And even though I just said it kind of as offline, like in the paranormal, like we always talk about ghosts and entities and energies and stuff like that. But like, it was a toss out line of a ghost doing feng shui in your house. But like, I have a friend named Heiso who lives in Japan, who does feng shui for Japanese businesses. Like, that's his job. Like, when the stock starts to drop, they will bring him into the office building and have him rearrange the furniture, and the stock will go back up literally like the next day. Like, one time he walked into, I think it was Sony was losing a bunch of money, and they brought him and his team, and they noticed that the accounts receiving room for Sony All of the desks were faced toward the elevator. And so he was saying, like, what's happening is the money is falling down the elevator chute and going out the front door.
Yep.
So he had them build a wall in front of the elevator. And the next day, Sony's stock like skyrocketed.
I don't believe in coincidence. How about you?
Yeah.
I think that is witchcraft. That is the manipulation of energy. It's just called feng shui. But it's the manipulation and the restructuring of energy. It's not just a human machination. It's working with the energy that already exists and tapping into it, I think.
Yeah. And that's why, like, I mean, we all know this, and everybody that's watching knows this too. Like, sometimes it's not a ghost in someone's house that's bad energy. Like, you can walk in and it might be a chair is in the wrong place, and you're like, something screwed up with that chair. It just needs to be over like 2 more feet. And if you move it over 2 more feet, the whole place is fine.
Yep. Yep. Absolutely. And you two had a chance to meet my friend Erin. And you know, she does Reiki healing. She does distance. What do you call it? I can't remember. Brain fog, COVID brain. But anyway, she sent some energy the other day while the nurse was here visiting my mother. And we had a very important conversation during that visit that she was not aware of until I called her after the nurse left. But it was validation for her, because I said, you know, I don't know what was going on during that meeting. My sister Christine was here, my sister Cindy, me, my mom, and the nurse, the head nurse. And I said, but about halfway through our group session where we were discussing some really important things, the whole energy shifted. And then I looked at my phone, and there was a text message from her from about 30 minutes prior that said, I just sent some Reiki your way for everybody, mom for her neck and you for, you know, this and Chris for that. And just white light around everybody. And, you know, how's Cindy doing? Well, that coincided precisely with this like shroud, like this pallor of darkness just lifted off of us. And suddenly all of us were talking about, and the future holds, and we're moving forward with this. And, you know, this decision is now made and it's off the table. And like, it was just like breathing spring air after a long frozen winter. And you get that first whiff of spring and the promise of the blossoms to come. And it coincided to the minute that zapped us from 500 miles away.
When I was working on the spinoff of Paranormal State, we did this case, and we were trying to track down a family that had owned a property, and we knew very little about them and their history. But part of what we were doing was, I was at a library with one of the kids, and we were doing historical research, and then the other kids were in the house with the mom, and they had her hooked up to like a heart monitor and a blood pressure machine, and they were just taking vitals for her. And when we discovered the name of the property owner in the library, her blood pressure 30 miles away spiked and her heart rate started accelerating.
Wow.
And it was, we didn't know in the library it was happening, because we were filming with our crew in the library and that crew was filming in the house. But later on, when we told them, everything's time marked because it's on camera.
Sure.
And so all of a sudden we saw that, like, literally in the moment we discovered the name of the man who had died in the house, the mom who lived in the house currently, like, her vitals just went crazy. And it was just such a weird moment of seeing that connectedness and having like evidence of it.
Yeah. And you know, for me, you know, it's great when we can actually document this kind of stuff, you know, chronicle these adventures, as it were, with timestamps and photos and, you know, everything that comes with this process. But I guess for me, I've lived with it for so long. George, my friend George Lopez, called me this morning. He's like, you know, don't you? I told him what happened with my mom last night in Hello when I walked into her room and she was sound asleep. And I walk across the threshold and I hear, Hello. I'm like, okay, I'm not the only one watching out over mom. This is good news. This is great, you know? Other people might not react that way. You know, the first thing they think is, oh, danger, Will Robinson, intruder. You know, well, there's no intruder. There's somebody that loves her as much as I do that's watching over her. And mm-hmm. that was validated for us last night. And George is like, well, did you write it down? Did you write what time it was? And I'm like, no. And I don't need to.
Yeah, that's one of those things. Jess and I talk about it all the time. And I talk about it at lectures. And you talk about it like... It is great to have documentation for all of this stuff, but like your best photograph, your best recording, your best videotape is not going to prove anything to anyone. These experiences are meant to enlighten us and change us. They're so personal to us. Like, and then what's amazing about them is they happen to us. We might not have any documentation, but then when we share our experience with other people who have experiences, that's where the magic really comes into play.
That's where the magic is. Absolutely right. Yep. And I think that, you know, the words, I love you are the most powerful words in this and, or any other language, but equally powerful is I believe you. Mm-hmm. I believe you. And John, I've watched you for years and years interacting with people at all the different events that we go to, and you do exactly what I do. You listen, you absorb what's being said, and then you know if somebody's telling you the truth. And even if you don't use the words, that vibration, that frequency is attained between yourself and the person that you're interacting with, and both are equally uplifted. And it really all comes down to, I believe you. Because how often, John, have you been told something that that individual never, ever told anyone else, ever, and trusted you or trusted me enough with this intimate, personal experience that might have even actually happened in their childhood, and they never told a parent, they never told a sibling, they grew up, they got married, they had their own family, they never shared it with anyone, but they look into your eyes for the first time and they tell you a story that is integral to their development, their personality, who they are, who they became, because they had that singular experience that touched them so profoundly, and they kept it inside for their whole life, and then they told you.
Yeah, it's an amazing experience, and Jess knows this, and we've talked about it too. You know, I always wanted to be a historical researcher and study weird stuff, but like the reality of the situation is, like, I got my two magic powers, if I have any, are like listening and talking, right? And the ability to create a safe space for people to talk about something that they've never talked about ever. So many times, I mean, I know people yell at me because I never sit at my table at conventions. I know, you know, we're always outside smoking or talking.
Mingling.
But those are the moments when you're walking through and someone says, can I just talk to you for a second? And then they pull you into a corner and like feel okay with telling you something they've never told anyone before. How amazing is that? And it frustrates me to no end to hear other people say, like, I can't listen anymore to the fucking stories. Like, and that happens a lot at conventions. People say that all the time.
It's very unfortunate. I've run across it myself. And my response whenever I hear anything like that is simply this. That's why I'm here.
Yeah.
That's why I'm here.
Yep.
To have this interaction, to have these magical moments with these extraordinary people.
And the ability to see the magic. I say this sometimes at my lectures, you know, I have a lot of weird stories. You have a lot of weird stories. Justin's got a lot of weird stories. But like, your weird story is enough. It's not a competition. You don't have to be abducted by aliens every Tuesday. You don't have to have a ghost living in your house. Sometimes a person's weird experience is they had one time when they were 12, a really weird coincidence, and it stuck with them and stuck in their heart their whole life, and they've never told anyone about it. That's just as weird and amazing as all of the other crazy weird stories that everybody has, because it's theirs and it meant something to them and it helped shape the way they think about things. You know, it's funny when people are like, oh, I think I was doing Amy and Adam's pre-Kindred Spirits show tonight. And Chip Coffee said something about, like, if you could live in my brain and have all the experiences I had. Like, first of all, I would never wish that on anyone.
Not on anyone.
I don't want anyone to ever have to live in my brain. But the reality is, like, your experience is enough. You don't need mine. Like, the seeing a feather on the ground that you understand is a message from the cosmos.
Yes.
Going outside and having the wind blow on your face at the right time, that's a message from the cosmos. And if you, like, it's just amazing to me. And I get frustrated when people think that their amazing experience isn't amazing.
I'll say too, like, even with my tattooing, like, I have people open up and tell me things they've never told people in their entire life. Like, ghost stuff or trauma stuff or go to jail stuff. I think it's a testament to all of us that we are that person that people feel like opening up to inherently. Like, we're not even doing anything, but they know that they're going to be safe with us. And that's probably why we three click so much.
I really do think that that's true, Jess. I remember the first time that I embraced you physically, like I, you know, physically put my hands on you and held you in my arms and felt your vibration. And I could see, most people have auras, but some people have coronas, which I think is a sign of being hybrid. But that's a whole nother show for a whole nother night. But I remember feeling you, and I leaned over. Do you remember me leaning into your ear and saying to you, I knew I knew you?
No, I don't.
Yeah, I did. I knew I knew you. And you just kind of pulled back a little bit and looked at me and then hugged me again. And, you know, and it was like, boom, there it is. Okay, good. We're good. And
I'm glad that you're saying nice stuff to Jess, because I don't ever.
No. I know. I've heard that you can, you know, be rather hard on her. And she gives it back to you double barrel. I know this, too. This I know as well. So, you know, we'll play paranormal together next weekend. What are we doing? It's a Midwest something, right? It's in Holy Toledo.
Yeah, Midwest Parafest.
That's
in
it.
In Toledo. Heather.
It's at the Oliver House. This will be... Well, Tenney, you did some before me, or was that your first one when we did that other one?
Andrea and I did the first one, which was in Pontiac. That was Heather's first event in Pontiac.
Yes.
Then they moved the second one you came to.
Yeah.
So this is either the third or fourth, maybe fifth. I've lost track of time.
Me too, completely. COVID brain, frog brain. Yeah.
Year four.
Well, I'm really so looking forward to this, because first of all, I have to finish the story about this guy. Okay, I have to finish that story, which I can't even say on the air. Okay, so okay. We'll talk amongst ourselves when we get there. You know, the thing that I so appreciate. Well, first of all, I have to say, I'm going to say it on the air. I was blown away that you showed up at the farm on Halloween. And I looked at Tenney. I was like, oh my God, there's another man that looks just like Tenney. I lost it. I was not at my best that night because I was literally, I had just
you had a lot going on that night.
I did. I had just come from seeing a lifelong friend, probably for the last time, in a nursing home in a hospital facility not far away from the farm. Mm-hmm. And then to come back there, flustered, running a little bit late, wondering if I had all my ducks in a row, because I really like to have all my ducks in a row. And then to feel a tap on my shoulder and to turn around and to see you, and then to see Jess filming me seeing you. It was just a little bit more than this old lady's brain could take that night.
That was all Jessica's doing.
I know it was. You made magic happen. So, you know, coming full circle to the discussion of magic. It exists. Miracles happen every day. We need to pay attention to what's in our world. You know, I was what I wanted to do tonight, and we don't have the time, which means you have to come back, talk about the etymology of words. And one of the things that I wanted to discuss tonight is this whole notion of being woke. Because of course the name of my show is A World Awakening, as in, okay, so woke, which is now chiefly US slang instead of past tense of awake, is aware of and actively attentive to important societal facts and issues, especially issues of racial and social justice. Thank you, Bill. And I wanted to talk about how wonderful it is to be magical and to be woke, to be awakened, that it should not be cast as an aspersion or a slur on anyone, but instead should be worn as a badge of honor, you know, because what we have to go through in life to get to the point where we are awake, both all of us knowing that once you awaken, you cannot go back to sleep. You know, you can't unlearn, unknow, unhear, unfeel, unexperience this thing called life and death and afterlife. And it's all amalgamated into this grand recipe for sometimes disaster, but sometimes the perfect souffle. And so we only have 5 minutes left, but I wanted both of you to be able to you know, spend a moment and speak to that, to the etymology of that word and what it means to you.
Do you want me to go first? You can go first, Jeff.
It's not that hard to understand. It's exactly what you said. Woke means... what you said, we're aware of other people and how, oh gosh, and how their life is for them and how we need to look out for certain people. It's not that hard. And people saying that's wrong, they know exactly, they're not stupid. They know exactly what they're saying. They just don't care about other people, don't want anybody around them who's not like them. That's their problem. But now it's been weaponized and it's just a stupid word. And
yes, all it means is enlightened. That's all it means. And it came out of the vernacular that was created around the Black Lives Matter movement. Oh hello, Toad. Toad. Do you want to say goodnight to Miss Peanut Buttercup?
Who's there, Toad?
There's Toad. So, John, how woke are you at 11 o'clock on a Friday night, darling?
So, you know, I love words and I love etymology and I love that stuff. And all of that, like... So woke, the Proto-Indo-European root of woke is weg. It's W-E-G. And weg means powerfully lively. Weg is also the root to witch. It's the root to Wiccan. It's
powerfully lively.
Yeah, powerfully lively, right? Like... It's so strange that this word, much like I talk about in my lectures, like weird gets thrown around as a slur on you.
As a slur.
When it's actually a compliment.
It is.
And we're at the same way with woke. Like people saying, you know, we can't stand all these lively, active, awakened policies. You can't? What is wrong with you? Like... We seem to be alive in this seemingly shared reality. Let's be alive and lively, right? Yes. There's nothing wrong with that. And I just find it really funny how words get twisted like that.
Weird mean one who determines their own destiny?
Yeah, those who manifest their own destiny. Being weird and woke is a pretty great thing.
and what is the etymology of gnome? We can close on it's such a happy note.
A spirit of the earth.
Yes. Spirit of the earth. Well, my darlings, I love you both with all my heart. I will see you in about 7 or 8 days. I will have a little companion. I lost him. There he is. With me on my travels. He's going to be a very, very well-traveled gnome. He's going to be at probably 35 or 40,000 feet for the first time in his existence. It's an exciting time to be alive.
It's an exciting time to be a spirit of the earth.
It is indeed. Thank you so, so much for joining.
Love you, my friend.
Thank you for having us. Love you.
I will close the show as I do every single week, reminding all of us that we are all in this together and always, to the extent that you can muster the energy, be the light you seek. And on that happy note, good night to all. Thank you so much for joining me.